Hi everybody, Harry Platcow here with another Artist Corner. Our guest tonight is a well-respected photographer from the area. He has done more exhibits than you can ever imagine, and we'll find out where he's being exhibited. Ladies and gentlemen, Mike Zeis.
Hi Harry, thanks for inviting me here.
Yeah, well thank you, man. Thank you for being here. We're going to be showing a lot of your photography today. And Jerry, just rip through these photos here.
I brought these because I wanted to, you know, most of what we're going to focus on here, we have a waterfall shot. Next, I take portraits as well. But today's focus is going to be on some of the roadside things I see, like this shot, for instance.
You do so much Americana in your photos.
Exactly right. We're not seeing the firewood shot. That's the next one. Yeah. So this is an example of what I see on the roadside. You know, as I drive along, and today's there's a lot of things to see on the roadside. Old houses. You got businesses. You've got junkyards. But today it'll be signs that I've seen. And in particular, the focus today might be called signs that sort of show an aspect of the handmade, as this one does. Look, it's like shark teeth on the top, the way the person has done this. You could just imagine there's a lot of personality here of the business. These are small businesses. Sometimes they're still going. You know, this guy is still selling firewood. Sometimes the business is defunct. Either way, the signs are out there. They're sort of primitive when they were made, and they show the signs of age. In a way, I look at them as folk art. So that's what we're doing. I took this shot in Easton, Mass. The next one is probably one of the most primitive shots I've got here today. This is a tattoo shop up in Worcester. I took this with I use a lot of strange cameras. I took this on expired black and white film.
Wow.
And put that in what is called a Diana clone camera, and that's the next shot up, is a shot of the camera. This I got for $3 at a yard sale. The guy who was selling it to me, the box weighed so little because it's all plastic that he didn't know. He said, there's probably not a real camera in there, but I knew it was a real camera. That's the camera I used to take that tattoo picture.
Let me ask you something.
Go ahead, Harry.
When you go out on a shoot, are you thinking thematically? Are you out and shoot just taking pictures of signs, pictures of buildings? When you go out, what goes into the project for you?
Oh, it's highly circumstantial. The roadside stuff, most of the time I see the roadside photos or see the roadside subjects and catalog them. I can't always pull off the road right then and take the picture.
Right.
So, and sometimes I actually take written notes about where they are, make a GPS mark, at some time I'll specifically go out to get a picture of that particular item.
Cool.
Now that was the way it was with let's go back one and show you that tattoo sign again. That's the way it was with this one. I saw that and I wasn't able to take a picture that day. Mm-hmm. But then I went out, I loaded the camera. I wanted to take, it was a crude thing. I mean, this person made this out of a piece of sheet metal and carved it with, obviously he's handy with a welding torch because he carved the holes out of it. And it's, I mean, you don't necessarily, I don't have any tattoos, but I would want somebody to have great graphics on the outside of their store if I was going to get a tattoo. And indeed, they do. The main sign for the main entrance to the store has wonderful graphics on it. But this is just wonderful to identify the parking spaces.
Was this taken on film?
Yes, it's film. Everything here today is film.
And you developed the film yourself?
Black and white film I developed myself, Harry. And this one I can fix. It has a lot of spots and things like that, but I decided because of the crudeness of the subject that I would just sort of leave the...
Was it taken with Tri-X, and did you push it to any degree?
Oh, gee, I can't tell you that.
No?
No. Okay. I forget what kind of film. It's expired film, which is one reason why you have to... I'm not very good with charcoal as an artist. I'm not a sketcher.
Yeah.
But this is as close as I come to charcoal with a camera.
Cool.
So,
let's skip
there's
over.
Another one. Yeah, let's go forward, too.
Whoa.
This is a picture of a beware of the dog sign, a no trespassing sign. I took this actually as opposed to the previous shot, which was taken with a very primitive camera that I bought in a yard sale. This was taken with a legitimate Olympus OM-1, very nice, high quality 35mm film camera. You can see that this is a homemade sign, but the person, it was made by somebody who's a legitimate artist. For sure. Look at the detail in the eyes. The eyes,
a lot of people
sort of
would have
terrifying eyes.
A lot of people would have dismissed that shot, but you captured it beautifully.
Thank you, Harry. And so the other thing is that, you know, this shows the effects of the weather.
Yeah.
And
that
really, for me, adds to the picture. Running around taking pictures you're not supposed to do is take pictures of other people's art. Well, I really am sort of a documentarian of this stuff.
There you go.
But somehow the weather has enhanced this by putting those stripes, a wood grain across it, that gave it a lot of appeal for me. You can see, I'm tempted to sort of lean over here and sort of show you the right up here. You can see the bottom side of the letters going here, and all the way in the right-hand corner as well. So when I got this picture back, I wanted to focus on the dog, so I cropped out the words.
Right.
But the full picture shows beware of the dogs.
It makes a wonderful point.
With wonderful lettering, too. So this was a real artist, and this was in a place where they were tearing the building down.
Mm-hmm.
They were tearing the building down, the fence was sort of leaning over a little bit, so whatever it was they were trying to protect, the business was long gone.
Now, this was taken on film. What kind of film were you using?
I'm going to blank on that, Harry.
Okay.
You can keep asking me, but I'm probably not going to remember any of them.
Okay.
I've got a... So let's go on to the next one. This is another one taken with a different kind of a cheap plastic camera, sort of to keep with the fire motif. Let's move forward one more.
Okay.
I hope I don't have to give your viewers the impression I'm racing through these, but I'm very excited by all of this stuff,
cool.
Harry. This one was taken by on what's called a baby brownie camera. It shows the sprockets. This was in Woonsocket, Rhode Island.
The sprockets are of the film?
They're on the film, Harry. You know, you've loaded a lot of 35mm
film. I've never seen sprockets like that.
Okay, so... I'll do a little bit of an explanation of how this comes about. This was at a car wash place, and like many of the places where I take my pictures, if you go now, not only is the sign gone, but the building is gone. Mm. Change happens. That's the way it is. So I'm really glad that some of this stuff is documented. And this also qualifies, even though it's well done, it qualifies in my mind as a homemade sign.
Oh.
Because it is very unconventional. It's not something that comes out of a factory. It may not be even somebody who's a professional. A professional sign painter would have been more precise about the letters. The fact that this is flawed gives it a great deal of appeal
sure.
to me.
Yeah.
So let's go next and I'll show you just how this was made. This is a baby brownie camera in the middle. It's a camera that I got in I guess you could call it an antique store in Brimfield.
Mm-hmm.
I overpaid for this, but it was about $10.
Wow.
But a real charming camera. And it was made to take 127 film. There, up until about 10 years ago, there was one company in Croatia that still made black and white 127 size film. But if you wanted to take color pictures in a 127 sized camera, you had to load 35mm film into it.
Oh.
So, you know, that's what the picture on the right, the picture on the left shows you 35mm film, and on the right of the picture shows you the 35mm film loaded into the backing paper that goes into the camera. Of course, you have to do all this stuff in the dark.
You had a changing bag?
You do it in the changing bag. That's how it works.
Oh, my God.
And so that's what gives you the sprockets. You can see the wider 127 is a little bit wider.
I've never seen
And that. So the whole 35mm camera itself has a little box on the inside that cuts out the sprockets.
Uh-huh.
But in this case, the sprockets end up being part of the picture. So let's go back one so you can see how the sprockets are part of the picture. There you go. And now a newer film, modern film, in the last 20 years, has had this barcoding on it. Older film doesn't have that, so
right.
you just get bare sprockets all the way to the end. So that's my baby brownie. Now, when I got this baby brownie, one forward here to see the baby brownie again. A baby brownie, can you imagine? What a charming name. This little thing is about, it's a little tiny camera. When I got this camera from the shop, Harry, there was a roll of film already in it.
Mm-hmm.
And so, naturally, I was careful You know, I wound the film all the way through to the very end so it wouldn't get exposed when I just opened the camera.
Yeah.
And I developed the film. Who knows what's going to be on it? Quite a mystery.
Yeah.
You know, to see whether you get anything at all on it.
Yeah.
And then here it is on the next shot is one of the photos that was already in that camera.
Oh, my.
And it makes you wonder. There's zillions of questions. In the first place, this is a photo. I'm not an expert in bathing suit apparel by any means. And the people who are really couldn't peg it by a specific year, but generally in the 50s.
Yeah, in 50s.
People were going to say this was a shot that was taken in the 50s and has sat in that camera ever since.
Incredible.
We have no idea who took the picture. We just know that somehow or other, I've got the film. When the film came out of the, when the film was developed, it was like powdery stuff on it. You couldn't see through the film.
Is that the silver oxide?
Being transparent is important because otherwise you can't make pictures out of it. You can't see what's on it.
Right.
So it turned out that the backing paper had become part of the film itself over time in the camera all that time.
I don't remember backing paper on film.
Well, that's because you use 35 millimeter that comes in a little canister.
On that shot with the sprockets, did you want that effect when you took that photo?
Yes. Yes, I did.
Incredible.
So, yeah, when you do that stunt, there's a few... Yeah, you don't know. You take pictures. You know that you have that kind of film in there. And some, generally speaking, if the sprockets add to the picture, sort of make it a little bit quirky.
Yeah,
you keep it in there.
It did.
And you can conceivably crop it out, which is okay.
Next one, Jer.
Yeah. So here we go. A category that I love is bait science. I like it when people actually make cutouts. And so you know, here's a cutout of a fish. This has been modified greatly because it used to be a road sign that somehow this person commandeered and put attached his own cutout fish on the top, and it says live bait and tackle on it. I took this picture maybe 20 years ago, and it's out in Chepachet, Rhode Island, and I'd have to go there now and find it again because I can't tell you what street it's on or anything like that, Harry. But I do know because I passed it a couple of years ago that they've improved the sign.
Oh.
But they have still kept the core, the primitive core of the sign is still there. And I'm very delighted that somebody didn't come up there and steal the fish from the top of it.
Right.
So it's just a wonderful artifact. This was taken, let's go to the camera that took it. It's a pinhole photograph. The next picture will show you the camera that took it. This was a kit camera that my darling wife Joanne gave me for a gift. You sand the parts down and assemble it together.
Wow.
It comes with, or you have to buy a lens separately, but in this case, I took the lens off and put a pinhole instead. So this is no lens at all, and it just shines a light. You leave the shutter open, as it were, for a long, long time. You actually hold your finger over the shutter because it's not really, doesn't apply. It hasn't got a shutter.
And you mentioned the f-stop as being somewhere in the hundreds?
Yeah, f260 or so.
Wow.
It's not a kind of thing. I tell you, there are people who, they have timing calculators on the web for pinhole photography, but in essence, I do it by guesswork, Harry.
Is the image upside down?
The image comes, they all are upside down.
Incredible.
That's the way photography works, is images are always upside down. And this one, this kind of camera gives you a preview upside down that you can see through the back of the camera.
Right.
But when you have a pinhole in there, it doesn't let enough light in for the preview to even work. So there's even more of a sort of a point and hope aspect of it. Now in the front, you'll see the Polaroid film holder that on the front on this picture. And so that ends up going in the back of the camera.
Yeah.
You pull that blue thing out, and it exposes the Polaroid film in the back.
Right.
And so that's how that particular shot was made.
Do you know how long the exposure was on that live bait sign?
I don't keep records about that stuff.
Yeah.
But I'd say that usually you go in with a 30, 60, 90 second kind of a thing.
Okay.
You know, if it's regular film, you know, you can go, if you're way off on the 30 and it's way overexposed, you then try 5, 10, and 15
and see
how that works.
You bracket.
So even though the Polaroid film is expensive, you burn a few going through to you know, get yourself on target.
Yeah. So next one, Jer.
So where are we going? Harvester bait and tackle. So this is with This is up in Rye. I'm looking at my notes here. Rye, New Hampshire. A great, great cutout. And this goes like this might be a good 6 feet wide.
Wow.
So it's a rather these are 2x4s over here holding it up. So mm-hmm. And this is off season. There was nobody to ask, but somebody told me that that's a striper. Who knows? You can call that number and find out, right?
There you go. There you go.
This was on ektachrome in a large format camera. Mm. Actually, it was in a Polaroid camera for which they don't make film anymore. So large format, let me see whether, oh yeah, I do have the example with me. We'll see how this works. Visual aids. So this is a sheet of 4x5 film, and this is how big the negative is.
Right.
Now, let's go to the next picture. And this is the camera I took it with. It's a Polaroid 150. It took roll film when it was born.
Mm-hmm.
And roll film is one of the first kinds of film that Polaroid stopped making.
Mm.
So you can get this camera. I did. I got that camera at a Salvation Army store for about $10.
How fast was the lens, do you know?
I know, Harry. I don't know.
Okay.
So, yeah, this does have adjustments, and the adjustments, it has an f-stop adjustment. I don't believe the lens speed is adjustable.
What size film did it take?
Polaroid had its own numbers for it, but I found out that if you open up the back, turn the next slide, please. Here's the camera back opened up. If you open up the back, you can stuff a piece of 4x5 film in there.
Yeah.
Close it up again. You can see it's got two doors.
Yeah. You'd have to do that in total darkness.
You do it in total darkness. Yeah. You have to work the levers. You have to stuff the film in. It's one shot at a time. It's the most cumbersome thing you can imagine.
Yeah.
But the thrill is you get a shot from a camera that other people would think is a throwaway.
Yeah.
And the lens is a pretty darn good lens.
Mm-hmm.
And so on those early Polaroids, they really made them nice. And so you get to, in a strange way, you get to use something that's old and forgotten and unusable to take what I consider to be a pretty fine photograph. And plus, it's crazy.
Yeah.
Who else would like do all this crazy setup? So let's go on then. This is probably the last of the bait signs. This is not a cutout at all. When you sort of roam around, this is in Providence, East Providence, I think. Ocean State Bait and Tackle.
Was this taken on ektachrome by chance?
No, this would have, it might have been.
It looks ektachrome.
It might have been.
Yeah.
I do know that when you go to this, it took me a while. The strategy here on this shot, it has nothing to do with the technology this time,
yeah,
is that you have to find a time when there's not a car out there, somebody buying bait.
Right.
You know? And you also have to sort of stand in the middle of the street and risk getting killed.
Mm.
But in this case, it worked out just fine. It turns out, when I brought the picture back to show the proprietor that the niceness of the shot I got, it turns out that this was... the lady was who drew this, wife of the owner, was a RISD grad.
What was it?
RISD, Rhode Island School of Design.
Oh.
So it looks like fine art because it is. And she says she goes out now and then and touches it up because of the graffiti and things like that. And
cool.
I understand lately that they have split up, but the sign is still there.
Cool.
She said something nice to me. She said, you know, here I got a RISD degree and I'm cutting bait. So it is... When you go take pictures of these quirky things, if you do meet people, most of the time it's a good meeting.
Yep.
Most of the time it's a good meeting.
They give you a bucket of worms?
I did not get a bucket of worms. They're in business. If you're in the business of selling bait, you don't want to give anything away.
Yeah.
They actually sell tackle. I know a guy who did. He got himself a good $300 setup there. So, you know, if you are interested in, it's not just selling worms.
Next one, Jer.
Sea worms. This is up in Raleigh, Mass, North Shore. This was taken with an Argus C3 camera, and it's one that my friend James Serpernat, who has really taught me a lot about these primitive cameras,
mm-hmm.
he and I, we got this Argus C3, and he knows how to take them apart and clean them and get the shutter to fire properly and mm-hmm. things like that after 50 years of sitting in a mm-hmm. shelf somewhere. And we did that, and it warns you in the guidebook that if it's a two-part lens, and if you forget which way they go, your pictures are going to end up weird.
No.
And you won't know, because it's very difficult to tell whether the lens is upside down or not.
Right.
It says you won't be able to tell till you get your first roll back.
Yep.
I got my first roll back, and it had this in focus in the center of out of focus around.
Yep.
And I said, this isn't right, but I'm not going to fix it.
Yep.
So that's what you get with sea worms. And the other thing is, what fun this person must have had drawing the little legs on that sea worm.
Yep.
Huh?
Yep.
Had to have been off season.
Yeah.
Because in season, he'd be too busy selling worms. So I had to go back on that one. My first, this is Raleigh, Mass, and that's a good 2 hours from home.
I have no idea where that is.
It's up by Gloucester.
Oh, okay.
Up by, you know, it's south of Portsmouth, New Hampshire, by just a little bit.
Yeah.
And the first roll of film didn't come out right. It just wasn't right, so I had to go back for a second effort. So let's move on. I'll show you the Argus C3, the camera that took this. The pivotal, they made it from the mid-30s until the 60s.
Yeah.
And look at this. This is the thing that really appeals to me is that they have, you grab this wheel to focus the camera.
That was the focusing ring.
That was the focus. And the whole entire focus apparatus is on the outside of the camera. It's got gears that you can actually see work. It's like a watch that's upside down or inside out. And so that, it appeals to the tech weenie among us.
What size film?
35 millimeter. And so this was, at that point, Leica was out there already with a third. They called them miniature cameras at the time because it was a lot smaller than the big 4x5.
Right.
Or medium format cameras.
Yeah.
They called a miniature camera. Leica was out there, and you could buy a car for what you could buy a Leica for.
I know.
And here was one, the Argus company said, we can come up with something for the common person.
Good.
And so that's why they sold millions and millions of these things. How are we doing on time here, Henry?
Jerry, how are we doing on time?
Okay, he says move on, so we'll do that.
Next one, Jer? Yeah.
So here's another category. Like, if you're selling bait, you tend to, your product lends itself to having a cutout sign.
Mm-hmm.
Less so with vegetables, but to an extent. So let's move into the vegetable category. I took this shot in Houston, Texas, as a matter of fact, a produce shed at a giant flea market. And this was a mega flea market. They had three giant long sheds. And it was not in the upscale part of Houston,
mm-hmm.
which added tremendously to the appeal. If you haven't been in the Southwest, when you do, it's not on the tourist guides at all, but you got to go to a flea market to see what the life is like there.
Mm-hmm.
And it was really an eye-opener for me. And so we had all of these sort of happy, every vegetable there is delighted to be there. <That's>, look how happy they are.
Cool.
I took that with a plastic camera, with a Vivitar Ultra Wide and Slim. I've got one right here in my pocket. They call it ultra wide because this has a...
That camera there.
This guy has a 22 millimeter lens instead of a more common 28. So you bring in a lot. And one of the things with the 20, with the smaller, with the wider
angle,
wider angle, you get to have a smaller camera, one that will fit into your pocket.
Yeah.
So that's the way that works. And I actually, as a matter of fact, I got a picture of it next. So let's go skip by the ultra wide and slim picture. And here we go, blueberries. Next one up is blueberries. This is in Uxbridge, Mass. Mm-hmm. Also taken with this swell camera that I've just shown you. And what a wonderful way to advertise your business.
Mm-hmm.
As a matter of fact, I complimented when I went there to pick blueberries. Now, I've never gotten out of there spending less than $25 on picked blueberries. It's a short season. When I went to compliment the guy on his signs, he said, a lot of people like them. Somebody stole one of them.
Oh.
I can imagine, it's like stealing a Christmas tree. How can you get any joy out of something, stealing a blueberry sign?
Yep, yep.
But... So one of the things I do to get that color in the sky with a plastic lens is I carry, there's no filter threads on this camera.
Oh. But so you held the polarizer?
I hand hold the polarizer. I rotate it with my hand until it's getting the right kind of blue.
Yeah.
And I put the camera in back of it and take the picture.
Cool.
And that's the way you do it. And in this case, the blue against blue works because I got a little bit of shadow there. I'm really delighted the way that one worked out.
Yeah.
And so then we can move into the corn category with the next picture. Uh-huh. And here's an ear of corn that's waving at us, Harry.
Yeah.
This was actually taken with a Bronica medium format camera. Okay. So it's not only crude cameras I use. This is a pretty serious camera from a professional photographer that wasn't doing photography anymore. And so I end up with a very, very nice camera.
Bronica.
Great, great lens. And this is on, it gets some extra texture because the people who made this corn sign put it on particle board.
Yep.
And you can see it's almost abstract the way the kernels work.
Yeah.
It's sort of the almost like popcorn kernels, isn't it?
Sure.
But this is the wonderful thing about this kind of art is that it's asymmetrical. It has this arm that's waving at you. It sort of gets it gets at the essence of what corn is.
Yeah.
Without really truly being an ear of corn. And then, you know, if you use particle board, that really does get beat fast. It starts beat the day you make it, so that's why it's almost got like a stucco appearance.
Cool.
Yeah. So next up, this one was in Uxbridge, Mass, where I live. It's a very symmetrical piece of corn, and this is even more abstract.
Mm-hmm.
It's sort of got the corn colors, but no detail at all. And just in case you sort of wondered what it was, I identify it as corn.
Looks like corn to me.
Looks like corn to me. And so I guess the next photo will be the last one up, Harry.
No problem.
Which is, this ends up being one of my favorites for a few reasons. I took this with an Olympus camera, Olympus XA, full frame 35 millimeter that will also fit into my pocket, a little tiny camera. It. This was another one where I had to hand hold the...
The filter. Yeah.
And to get this particular angle, it was early in the morning, so I was soggy by the time I got down there.
Okay.
And I dropped the filter.
Oh.
And you're doing a lot of things with your hands at once, because not only do you have to hold the camera, this is one that actually has shutter speed and focus adjustments to make, plus holding the filter. So with all of this going on, I dropped the filter, and it was down there in the muck.
Mm-hmm.
And so I sort of dusted it off a little bit, and that adds a little bit of dewiness to the picture.
You're an avant-garde photographer.
It's a flaw that I will accept. And so, you know, if you want to talk about sort of the berserkness of the people making the signs, this guy noticed with the kernels, each one is so nicely defined, but they go sideways. Have you ever eaten an ear of corn like that?
No.
It's really too strange for words. The rows of corn
sideways.
Go sideways.
Try eating it upside down.
And you know, he's boiled down. He's got like the essence of the corn is there, but he's all ear and very not so much the husk. Mm-hmm. You know.
Yep. Hey, we're talking to Mike Zeis, everybody, a wonderful photographer, and we're going to have to wrap it up. So I thank you very much for coming down.
Harry, it's a pleasure.
It's been my pleasure. And we will see you next month, everybody. Hopefully, Don Acavelli will bring in some of his folk art. In the meantime, if you're so blessed, call your mom. And if it's within your purview, I'm a vet. Take care, everybody. We'll see you soon.